chapter 12th and 13th shloka. But before that, we will also read the Chetushloki Bhagavad Gita and then start the session. I will not do the Mangalacharan because that's already been done by Samba Prabhu. Bhagavad Gita as it is, 10th chapter, Chetushloki, we will go through. Aham sarvasya prabhavo matta sarvam pravartate iti matva bhajante mam buddha bhava saman vitaha machitta madgata prana bodhayantaha parasparam katha yantascha mam nityam tusyanti cha ramanti cha tesham satata yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam ददामि बुद्धि योगंतम येन माम उपयान्तिते तेषां एवानुकम्पार्थम् अहम् अज्ञानजं तमः नाशयामि आत्मभावस्तो ज्ञान दीपेन भाष्वता. I am the source of all the spiritual and material worlds. Everything emanates from me. The wise who perfectly know this engage in my devotional service and worship me with all their hearts. The thoughts of my pure devotees dwell in me. Their lives are fully devoted to my service, and they derive great satisfaction and bliss from always enlightening one another and conversing about me. To those who are constantly devoted to serving me with love, I give the understanding by which they can come to me. To show them special mercy, I, dwelling in their hearts, destroy with the shining lamp of knowledge the darkness born of ignorance. Hare Krishna, this is the Chetushloki Bhagavad Gita. So after Krishna tells, so today we'll be covering the text of 10th chapter, 12th and 13th shloka. So here, after listening to Chetushloki Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna is now telling his response. Yeah. So since a very important matter has been told to him, so he basically has to acknowledge and respond, because Arjuna has accepted Krishna as his teacher in the beginning of Bhagavad Gita itself in the chapter 2nd, shloka 7. So statistically also, this shloka has got an interesting significance, because in Bhagavad Gita, in the 8th chapter, 2nd shloka, is the last time Arjuna speaks. So entire 8th chapter, which has got 28 shlokas, so 26 shlokas Krishna straight away tells about so many things. The Arjuna asks 6 questions, he answers those 6 questions. Matter of death is very well covered in that chapter. And then in the 9th chapter also, there is Arjuna does not ask any question. 34 shlokas. So 26 plus 34 shlokas, Krishna directly speaks. And in the 10th chapter also, it's Krishna speaking till 10.11. So almost 70 plus shlokas, 72, I think, 71 or 72 shlokas, Krishna is directly speaking. So it's like as if he has to take a pause, Arjuna speaks now. So 70 plus shlokas absorption Arjuna has got. Intent absorption in the middle of Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna got that knowledge and now he is opening up. So this is a very significant thing. Just like the way in Bhagavad Gita 2.7, Arjuna accepts Krishna as his spiritual master, his guide and well-wisher. Here, Arjuna takes that understanding into the next level. The shloka is also considered to be very important. Arjuna uvacha param brahma param dhama pavitram paramam bhavan purusham shashvatam divyam adi devam ajam vibhum ahustvam rishayo sarve devarshir naradas tata asito devalo vyasaha swayam chaiva bravishime. This is what Arjuna is telling to, is praising Krishna. Arjuna said, you are the supreme personality of Godhead, the ultimate abode, the purest, the absolute truth. You are eternal, transcendental, original person, the unborn, the greatest. All the great sages such as Narada, Asita, Devala, Vyasa, confirm this truth about you, and now you yourself are declaring it to me. So Arjuna is basically telling what he is, what is absorbed. Krishna telling him in seventh, particularly in 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th chapters, but most predominantly 7th, 8th, 9th, and 10th chapter till now. Similar understanding and similar message also goes in 11th and 12th chapters also. So anyone wants to volunteer to chant the shloka?
I'll chant, Prabhu. Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Yes. Yeah.
Arjuna uvacha param brahma param dama pavitram paramam bhavan purusham shashvatam divyam adidevam majam vibhum ahustvam rushayah sarve deva devarshir naradastatha asitho devalo vyasah swayam chaiva bravishime. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. So we will now go to the purport, because a long purport we will give. Read, anyone volunteers, any Prabhus who want to volunteer to read this page? And I request all of you to very attentively hear this purport, because there are a lot of things Srila Prabhupada has conveyed in this purport. After reading the purport, there are three pages, so three people volunteer, and after that we'll have a quick recap on this. So please read the, listen to this purport, read this purport as it is being read very, very carefully. Yeah. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. I'll read, Prabhu.
Yep.
Purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada, Jai Srila Prabhupada. In these two verses, the Supreme Lord gives a chance to the Mayavadi philosopher. For here, it is clear that the Supreme is different from the individual soul. Arjuna, after hearing the essential four verses of Bhagavad Gita in this chapter, became completely free from all doubts and accepted Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He at once boldly declares, "You are Param Brahma, the Supreme Personality of Godhead." And previously, Krishna stated that He is the originator of everything and everyone. Every demigod and every human being is dependent on Him. Men and demigods, out of ignorance, think that they are absolute and independent of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That ignorance is removed perfectly by the discharge of devotional service. This has already been explained in the previous verse by the Lord. Now, by His grace, Arjuna is accepting Him as the Supreme Truth in concordance with the Vedic injunction. It is not that because Krishna is Arjuna's intimate friend, Arjuna is flattering Him by calling Him the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Absolute Truth. Whatever Arjuna says in these two verses is confirmed by Vedic truth. Vedic injunctions affirm that only one who takes to devotional service to the Supreme Lord can understand Him, whereas others cannot. Each and every word of this verse spoken by Arjuna is confirmed by Vedic injunction. Hare Krishna.
So, any Mataji wants to volunteer?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Yes, Mataji.
In the Kena Upanishad, it is stated that the Supreme Brahman is the rest of everything.
For everything.
And Krishna has already explained that everything is resting on Him. The Mukunda Upanishad confirms that. Mundaka Upanishad confirms that the Supreme Lord, in whom everything is resting, can be realized only by those who engage constantly in thinking of Him. The constant thinking of Krishna is Smaranam, one of the methods of devotional service. It is only by devotional service to Krishna that one can understand His position and get rid of this material body. In the Vedas, the Supreme Lord is accepted as the purest of pure. One who understands that Krishna is the purest of the pure can become purified from all sinful activities. One cannot be disinfected from sinful activities unless he surrenders unto the Supreme Lord. Arjuna's acceptance of Krishna as the supreme pure complies with the injunctions of Vedic literature. This is also confirmed by great personalities of whom Narada is the chief. Hare Krishna, thank Hare. You.
Thank you much. So, anyone volunteers to read this?
I can continue, Hare. Prabhuji. Sorry, yeah. Go ahead.
It's okay.
Krishna, it's possible to make it little bigger. Font can be made little bigger, Prabhuji.
Font is bigger only, Prabhu. Quite big.
Is it?
You should in your line screen, Prabhu.
Font my is screen. Bigger.
Yeah, you can read Matri.
Krishna is the supreme personality of Godhead, and one should always meditate upon him and enjoy one's transcendental relationship with him. He is a supreme existence. He is free from bodily needs, birth and death. Not only does Arjuna confirm this, but all Vedic literatures, the Puranas and histories. In all Vedic literatures, Krishna is thus described and supreme Lord himself. And also says in the fourth chapter, although I am unborn, I appear on this earth to establish religious principles. He is the supreme origin. He has no cause, for he is the cause of all causes, and everything is emanating from him. This perfect knowledge can be had by the grace of the Supreme Lord. Here, Arjuna expresses himself through the grace of Krishna. If we want to understand Bhagavad Gita, we should assert the statements in these two verses. This is called Parampara system, acceptance of disciplic succession. Unless one is in the disciplic succession, he cannot understand Bhagavad Gita. It is not possible by the so-called academic education. Unfortunately, those proud of their academic education, despite so much evidence in Vedic literature, stick to their obstinate conviction that Krishna is an ordinary person. Hare
Krishna. Hare Krishna. Mataji, in the two paragraphs that you have read, which line do you think has got a very powerful learning point? Mataji?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji.
Yeah, which line do you think is
Yeah, the first one is like, he is the source of everything. He is the cause of all causes, Sarva Karana Karanam. And the second one is like, we have to acquire knowledge or assert the statements within these things through the disciplic succession or the parampara system, which is made possible through the bona fide spiritual master. So once we are in the knowledge of the Krishna or the being knowing about he is the supreme personality of Godhead, then our ignorance will be removed and it will enhance us to progress in our path of a spiritual devotional path, and we will get out of this birth and death.
No, I will put this question again. I want any other volunteers to take up. Is there a very dominant learning point line in this two paragraphs regarding the understanding?
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Yeah.
Prabhu, to add to Mataji, I also feel the second paragraph, which talks about disciplic succession, is very important. For what I understand is, Prabhu, that it's a very vast knowledge. Krishna is supreme. But to understand truly Krishna, it is important we take guidance from a spiritual master who actually can tell us in detail about the whole process. So that for me is important.
Very good, Prabhu. Thanks a lot, Prabhu. Any other volunteers?
Yes, Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Yes, Prabhu.
Although I am unborn, I appear on this earth to establish religious principle. So I think this is the main important, because people believe Krishna is ordinary human being. So we have to stick to this line, in order to establish religious principle, he came to materialistic world. Otherwise, he is a supreme lord.
Thank you, Prabhu. Thanks a lot. Any other volunteers?
Prabhu, he has no cause, for he is the cause of all causes. That is very important, Prabhu.
Very good. Hare Krishna. Thanks a lot. I will, in the want of time, I'll move. But for me, if I look at it, it's a personal choice. I would see the second line of the second paragraph is the most important to me in terms of learning point. If we want to understand, if we want to understand Bhagavad Gita, we should accept the statements in these two verses. So unless we understand what is stated in these two verses, we cannot understand Bhagavad Gita. So we may say that Chatushloki Bhagavad Gita is important. 934 in Bhagavad Gita is essence, or the essence of Bhagavad Gita is also important. There are so many important shlokas, so many shlokas that we need to remember. But here Srila Prabhupada makes a very important point that if we want to understand Bhagavad Gita, we should accept the statements in these two verses. So then the question comes to us, what are these two verses? So because Srila Prabhupada has said this, if we are reading the purport in that sense, it's imperative on us to go back to see what this verse says. Yeah, so I'll go back to the verse, and I want some other volunteers to chant who have not chanted. Then we will go to the, we'll try to understand a bit about this shloka more, because again I repeat, Srila Prabhupada is saying that if we want to understand Bhagavad Gita, we must understand these two verses. So even if you are preaching about Bhagavad Gita to somebody, we can straight away take this shloka and ask them, you know, this is where the whole Bhagavad Gita, the crux of the Bhagavad Gita is there, and we need to understand this in order to understand Bhagavad Gita. Yeah, any other volunteers to read this shloka?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji.
Yeah.
Arjuna Uvacha Param Brahma Param Dhamma Pavitram Paramam Bhavan Usham Shashvatam Divyam Adidevam Ajam Vibhum Ahustam Rishaya Sarve Devarshi Naradas Tatha Asito Devalo Vyasa Swayam Chaiva Pravishmi.
Hare Krishna. Thanks a lot. So this is the importance of reading the purports of Srila Prabhupada, and time and again we need to make a very conscious attempt to use these purports in our presentations or even session. Even if a small topic is given, we definitely need to take the shelter of Srila Prabhupada's purports, because they give a very different perspective to us. Sometimes even if there is no purport, we may try to research in the Vani course on what Prabhupada has told about a particular shloka or a particular topic, and then we need to try to embed into our presentations or our teachings, because we are all about what Prabhupada's mercy and what Prabhupada's purports are about, right? So if Prabhupada had to say that we have to understand this to understand this, so let's try to So now, what are the important points? Remember, one important point is that we have to understand these two verses. But how do we understand these two verses? How did Srila Prabhupada understand, and how did Srila Prabhupada reveal to us this shloka, is a thing to remember. So so one by one, any volunteer can pick up this. In the purport of this shloka, or these two shlokas, whom does who refute? Who is refuted and how? It's there in the beginning of the purport itself. Here Krishna is being...
Hare Krishna Prabhu, I think the Mayavadi philosophers we are talking about.
Yes, and what does Prabhupada explain?
Prabhupada is explaining about the Supreme, how establishes the Supreme is different from the individual soul.
Very good. Thanks, Prabhuji. So, how does Arjuna accept Krishna as? Any volunteers?
Supreme Personality of Godhead, Prabhu.
Very good. Any other volunteers for the next question? Is Arjuna's acceptance because Krishna was his friend? Any other volunteer, please?
No, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Yeah. Yep.
Is it already answered, Prabhu? No.
Answer is no. Okay, quiz master. Okay, good. What are the verse, Vedic verses quoted by Srila Prabhupada to affirm the statements of what are the Vedic or which scriptures Srila Prabhupada took the help to affirm the statements of Arjuna? You don't need to quote the verse, but what are the Vedas that he has taken?
Can I try, Prabhu?
Yes, Prabhu.
Prabhu, he has quoted Kena Upanishad and Mundaka Upanishad.
Mundaka Upanishad. Yeah, and what did he say there?
Prabhu, in Kena Upanishad, he was referring to Krishna as the supreme abode of everything, supreme Brahman being the rest for everything. And in Mundaka Upanishad, he's also referring the same, wherein everything is resting in Krishna.
Very good. Thank you, Prabhu. And then, one second, Prabhuji. Okay, I want any Mataji volunteers to do this. What are the names of the, one second, Prabhu. What are the names of the great sages did Arjuna refer to?
Narada, Vyasa, Vyasadev. Then, Narthamani, Vyasadev. Yes, Prabhu. That's...
Anyone wants help, Mataji? You can also read the book.
Devala, right? Is it Devala as well?
Yeah, Devalo and Asita. Why I'm asking this, these are important thing to remember. So he's listing the great sages. Is there any point in Bhagavad Gita till now that what we have read where Krishna also uses? Here we see Arjuna using an example of some people to reaffirm what he has understood. And he says, not only me, but these great people are also saying, Narada and Asito, Devala, and of course, Vyasa himself, who is the author of the compiler of the Bhagavad Gita. Okay, my other question is there any point that we can remember where Krishna is also referring to someone saying that, please know, this person also has followed this. Prabhu,
yes, Janak Prabhu, Janak.
Very good. Yeah, Hare Krishna Prabhu. Thanks, Prabhu. Yeah, in which chapter, Prabhuji?
Prabhu, I think 3 or 4.
Very good, 3. Very good, Prabhu. Excellent, Prabhu. So Krishna also time and again refers to this kind of a thing. Whenever he tells a topic, then he takes a reference of that. And then, in which place in Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna himself taken example of himself, Krishna takes himself as an example. Anyone wants to tell this? He takes himself.
Prabhu, he don't need to do any work, but still he does it like so that he set the example for future generations.
Yeah, anyone wants to, anyone knows that shloka, at the beginning of the shloka?
Sriyam Sodharma.
No. Yad yad atrati srishta. Yeah. Krishna says whatever great men do, people follow. So that's reason. Okay, fine. And where does Srila Prabhupada talk about spirit of Bhagavad Gita here in this? Any volunteers for this?
By academic qualification, no one will get to know.
No, spirit of Bhagavad Gita.
Only by understanding through the mood of Arjuna, is that we are talking about, Prabhuji?
Yeah.
Okay. By surrendering.
But let's go to other question. What is the sign of false spread of academic education?
So they think that Krishna is the normal person.
Yeah, it's so great.
Yeah, they tend to accept Krishna as the ordinary person.
Okay. Well, they accept Krishna, or they think that Krishna is a person?
Yeah, they consider
Krishna as an ordinary person. Not.
And the spirit of Bhagavad Gita, as we are told, is, of course, someone has already answered it. I'm telling Srila Prabhupada here gives emphasis on the supremacy of the Lord, understanding that he is supreme, and mostly that understanding has to come through discipling succession. So in this way, this shloka has got its own very important. Prabhupada in his lectures, conversations also, you may find the references. He keeps referring, saying that even Arjuna has told that Krishna accepted Krishna as supreme personality of the Lord. Arjuna has accepted, and even other great personalities also have accepted Krishna as the supreme personality of the Godhead. So Prabhupada tries to refer this. So Prabhupada here basically establishes that Arjuna has accepted, not because Krishna was his friend, because he felt that Krishna was genuinely supreme. Because as we said, that he has heard about Krishna speaking about so many things, or almost 71 verses, right? And then Prabhupada is quoting the Vedas, Vedic references are given, parampara is given, and that's the reason why Srila Prabhupada said understanding of these two verses is very important after we have learned and understood the Chetushloki Bhagavad Gita. In Chetushloki Bhagavad Gita, what we are told in the Aham Sarvasya Prabhaho Marta Aham Sarvasya Prabhaho, what I'm suddenly forgetting. Aham Sarvasya Prabhaho
Mata Sarvam Pravartate Iti Matva Bhajate Maam Buddha Bhava.
That Krishna says, I'll also give the remembrance, I also give the forgetfulness. Sorry, Hare Krishna, I lost the concentration. Apologies. Aham Sarvasya Prabhu, Matta Sarvam Pravartate, Iti Matva Bhajante Mam, Buddha Bhava Samanyata. So Krishna is establishing, like the previous presenter also has told that Krishna is the supreme, and Krishna is telling that he is not only for all spiritual and material worlds, everything is a source. And in Machitta Madgata Prana, he says the people who understand this, and when they meet together, how do they derive pleasure? And in what way they derive pleasure? They derive pleasure in talking about him, talking about the greatness, talking about the pastimes of the Lord, Nama Rupa Guna Vishesha. And then if they're doing that, and they're doing that voluntarily and enjoying what they're doing, Krishna says that I will come within them, the Dami Buddhi Yogantam. I give them that actual intelligence for them. And then Krishna also tells that why he does it, Tesham Eva Anukampartham, to show them special mercy. To whom? To those devotees who are Bhajatam Priti Purvakam, who are enjoying by discussing the Bodhayanta Parasparam, and who know that Krishna is the source of both spiritual and material world. Krishna is source of everything. Shri Krishna Sharanam Samasta Jagatam. The people who are there, who have this understanding, they know who is Krishna, and they will be able to understand Krishna, and that's how they will be able to accept Krishna as a supreme personality. That's just the way Arjuna has accepted, not whimsically, but with a proper justification and understanding, taking the reference of Vedas, taking the teachings of the great sages who have themselves have read quite a lot, and they're very self-realized personalities, taking them as reference, it has been accepted and proved that Krishna is the supreme personality of the Godhead. And after these shlokas, few more shlokas come, where then Arjuna asks Krishna, requests Krishna to describe about some of his opulences. So from next week onwards, we'll quickly cover those, some of the opulences Krishna has given to Arjuna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So kindly remember this shloka. It's an important shloka, and we can also memorize it. And next week, we also encourage more devotees to participate and chant the Chatushloki Bhagavad Gita. And also, we also encourage devotees, if you have memorized this today's shloka, you can come and chant. or if you want to directly read by seeing also, we encourage you to do that. So that'll be nice for us to learn and listen to each other. And I'll just leave it here. And if anyone wants to comment or share their realization about this shloka, whatever they heard anytime, anywhere before, and before we go and delve into the opulences of Lord Shri Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, I have a question.
Yes, Mataji.
In second chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna was confident that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead or not. And in 10th chapter, he is confident now that he is the Supreme Personality. What about in second chapter? He was confident?
Second chapter, if you go to second chapter, 7th verse, Mataji, it's not the question of confidence or not. In the second chapter, if you see what Krishna says in the 7th shloka, okay, karpanya doshopata swabhavaha prichami tvam dharma sammudha chetaha yashreyasya nishitam bruhitanme shishyasteham shadimam tvam prapannam. Now I am confused about my duty and have lost all composure because of my miserly weakness. In this condition, I am asking you to tell me for certain what is best for me. Now I am your disciple and soul surrendered unto you. Please instruct me. So here the mood is to accept Krishna as guru, as a teacher, more than Supreme Personal of the Godhead. And there are, of course, in the Bhagavad Gita, we also see Arjuna referring to Sri Krishna in different names that indicate the greatness and opulence of Krishna. But only in 10th chapter, it is very specifically and he accepts conclusively. So see, there is something like this, right? I know the example that I can give you is, I have faith in you is one thing. I have confidence in you that you are good, but I have unconditional faith, irrevocable faith, univocal faith that you are good is another step. And to have faith that you can never ever be bad, you can always be very good only, is another level of faith, right? Belief or faith, whatever you may call it. So here in the 10th chapter, the difference is Arjuna is equivocally doing it. What it also means is that from this point in time onwards, Arjuna would not ask Krishna about his greatness or supremacy. All that he would ask Krishna is, please tell me about your opulence. That is in the remaining of the 10th chapter. And in the 11th chapter, he requests Krishna to show him his universal form. There is no question of lack of trust or lack of confidence. He basically wants to get more information about Krishna's supremacy. That's all. So I don't know whether I've answered your question or not. If anyone also wants to comment, most welcome. Hare Krishna.
Thank you.
Also, that is also a reason why you can also see from an analytical angle also, from 10th chapter, from this time onwards, you hardly have Arjuna asking any questions. It's mostly either seeking information and then Krishna telling straight away. Many, many chapters where a lot of things that Krishna tells comes in from now onwards. 10th, 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th. So there's more of Krishna telling Arjuna straight away. Whereas in 2nd chapter, 3rd chapter, 4th chapter, there is a bit of a question and answer that keeps happening. Hare Krishna.
The spirit of Bhagavad Gita, as you said, just correct me if I'm not correct, Prabhuji, that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, as we come to know from the disciplic succession. Is it? That is the spirit of Bhagavad Gita?
Yeah, I think so, Prabhu. Yes, correct. One second, Prabhu, if you don't mind, I'll also refer to my notes. Please hold on. I'll get my notes. Hare Krishna. Yeah, Prabhu, small mistake I made. A spirit of Bhagavad Gita is accept in the mood of Arjuna as stated in 10, 11, 10, 12 and 13. This is parampara system. The mood of Arjuna and the parampara system is the spirit of Bhagavad Gita. So we are partially right, and mood of Arjuna is also important. Yeah, Hare Krishna. Anyone has any questions? Yeah.
How do I know the mood of Arjuna here?
Accepting Krishna as the Supreme Personality of the Godhead. And also giving importance to parampara system.
Obviously, the speed of Bhagavad Gita, yeah, that's fine. But there's another thing, you know, that Tushyam Tisha Ramandisha, that sentence, you know, which really very nice, that when devotees discuss Krishna and they derive the bliss from discussing about Krishna, that is one of the it's very, very important, you know, or kind of that can be considered also the another point of spirit of Bhagavad Gita, no?
Yeah, that is spirit of devotion.